Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
This is Gerald Antoine with European Dobermann Stud. This is one of the few dogs that I got. His name is Casanova. He's from Russia. He's from a kennel called Via Felicia. He's about 11 months, 3 weeks, 4 days, 26 hours, and 33 minutes old. But who's counting, right? What I love about Casanova is his tenacity, his drive, his willingness to work, no matter if he's tired, sleepy, full, or hungry. And for what I do with these dogs, I need a dog that has a high prey drive.
Yeah.
He's unnerved about anything. I mean, he's curious. He doesn't have any environmental issues. I got him as the pack leader out of the litter that I picked from. When I first got this dude, man, imported, you know, you never know what you get. You know what I'm saying? They can take you all kind of videos and photos. Take 30 videos and they're seeing the 29th one that's right out of the 31 that they videotape, right? And every video the breeder sent me, he was taking the ball and running away with it, and his litter mates was chasing him the whole time. And I like that. You know, guys, how I fell in love with the European Doberman was quite simple. The initial thing was the aesthetics, the size, the dark markings, the bigger head, the dark almond eyes. These are the things that the Europeans told me via the internet what they look for when they're looking for a top quality male. But also I fell in love with the fact that they were genetically bred to be personal protection. So I love this breed. I don't think I'm gonna ever go to a different breed ever again. You know, I did a lot of research, people, and there's a huge difference between American and European Dobermans. Like I said, I'm not a novice. I would consider myself somewhat of a expert. The Germans, they wanted to put back into the DNA the workability. So a lot of Germans now, a lot of breeders, they have some kind of working title, ZTP or IPO Schützen. And also bone structure. The bone density, the girth in the bone structure for the... Give me my pillow. No, leave it. Food. The bone structure is so much thicker on the Euros just genetically. The Americans, thinner. The head sizes are, for the most part, on men and women, male dogs, female dogs, are a little bit, see that, wider, you know? And I kiss my dogs, okay? Now, on my own, put my mouth in their tongue and shit, but I kiss my animals, you know what I mean? So I don't care what nobody said about that. But the one thing about the difference between American and the European is the Z factor. You know, with the American Lions, they can kick out blues, whites, fawns. And I don't generally too much like those colors because they're predisposed to skin issues, photosynthesis issues, nerve issues. He wants this ball, people. I'm telling you, that's a good damn sight. Now he's trying to tear up my pillows? So those are the huge difference. Oh, another thing, people. A European breeder, if you notice, they keep the dew claws on. And they only do that here in America where they remove the dew claws. Dew claws serves a purpose. And that purpose is for grabbing. And the Europeans keep those on there. That's how you can tell sometimes when, not all the time, but sometimes, that when a dog's been imported, a Doberman, is because the dew claws are not removed at all. So far, I've been 3 for 3 when it comes to importing. You know, that's another thing, guys. You know, when you import, you better import with somebody you have a good rapport with. You know, you're thinking you're getting a great dog, and you come to find out, this happened. Dog had a little incision in his chest. The breeder was like, well, puppies play hard. Well, puppies don't play that hard where you got keloid skin right there in a parallel line. Come to find out, the dog had a white spot, but she cut it out, sewed it up, sold the dog. Those are things that are deceptive that you don't have no control when you're importing a dog from another country. Now, if somebody's here in the United States, get on the plane and complain and go at his door. But you take your chances, and you gotta buy animals that are imported based off a relationship, trust, and documented paperwork. Like with him, all my dogs' parents, not grandparents, not great-grandparents, not 12 years ago, I don't care about that generational champion BS. You know, his great-great-grandsire. If you do the pedigree, he's what got 1% of his great-great-grandfather in him. All of my boys' parents have to have current working titles. Either ZTP, IGP, IPO, Ring Sport, something. Because then that gives me a scale on what to expect. Because prey drive is something genetic. You can't make a dog. If a dog doesn't have no drive as a puppy, you ain't gonna raise that drive up to the point where you're gonna be satisfied. I'd rather have a dog that have insane drive and I can bring it down and control it versus a dog that has no drive and break his spirit by trying to make him what he's not built for. So still nothing's guaranteed. I just give him all I can, give him all the love, feed him great food, great exercise, train him with the best trainers, Al Benuelos, Larry Hansen, AKA Ms. Hansen, Adrian Santano, all these people that I have a good relationship, they know what I expect of my dogs. And before they take $1 from me, they do a full week evaluation. Say, hey, he either got it or he ain't got it. Go with another one. And that's without taking my money. Because these dogs right here, having pets, unless you're blind, is a luxury, not a requirement. You know, so for me, if I'm gonna get a luxury item and it's gonna take premium gas, I'm gonna get the best training for them. My trainer's gonna tell me what's the deal before they send me a bill. You know, my ex-wife told me many years ago during our divorce, and I was having Dobermans then. I had two, Alonzo and Brody. She said, you know what? Your dogs defined you. And I had to think about that for like 10, 15 minutes. I said, you know what? I take that. Yeah, they do. And you know, in the Bible it says, you know, we are the keepers of the beast. And I'm always gonna keep me a couple of beasts.